Well, good morning, everyone. I have with me the Shadow Chancellor. He's had one of the great political careers of modern times. He's been Culture Secretary, Health Secretary, Foreign Secretary, and of course Chancellor of the Exchequer, and a member of the Cabinet for more than a decade. And not the least of his achievements was the personal vote that helped him achieve one of the most remarkable constituency results at the last general election. So, ladies and gentlemen, Jeremy Hunt. Shadow Chancellor, let me start by asking about our economic position. So Labour says things will get worse before they get better. Is that a picture you recognise?
Well, they will get worse if Labour makes catastrophic mistakes in the budget and hikes up tax in a way that destroys growth. And I think one of the biggest lies we've had since Labour came to office is this nonsense about having the worst economic inheritance since the Second World War. I note that not a single independent economist has been prepared to come forward and back up Rachel Reeves in that claim. And the reason is very straightforward. I mean, inflation 2%, jobs, a succession of Conservative governments that created 800 jobs for every single day that they were in office. And on growth, we wasn't just the fastest growth in the G7 when Labour took over, but the International Monetary Fund said that over the next 6 years, we are projected to grow faster than France, Germany, Italy, or Japan. So, I mean, that is a legacy, frankly, that I would have died to have when I became Chancellor. I think the economy's got very solid foundations. My worry is that Labour believes its own propaganda and starts taking a whole series of decisions, particularly on things like capital gains tax, which have a massive impact in deterring the investment in the economy that we really need.
What about that? They've got a specific claim about the budget, as you're aware, and I know you've combated Rachel Reeves quite a bit about this. So explain why it's not the case, in your view, that we have a £22 billion black hole in the budget that Labour now has to fill at the budget.
Well, you don't have to take my word for it. I mean, just read this week's Economist, where there's an article saying that she could actually have not a black hole of £22 billion, but a surplus of £39 billion to play with in the budget. The Financial Times did a Freedom of Information request to the Treasury to ask where this fictitious £22 billion number came back. And the reply they got back from the Treasury was, we can't give you the workings because we're not sure they're accurate. Even the Labour Party don't believe it, otherwise they wouldn't be having this massive row over the winter fuel allowance. But, I mean, the real concern I have is that since July the 5th, when Labour came to office, they have talked about difficult decisions, but actually they have not taken those decisions. Instead, they've spent all their airtime attacking their predecessors. Now, we lost that election. We accept that. We have a lot of learning to do. We've got a long journey to go on. But governing is about doing difficult things, making the arguments for those things. And about that, we have had nothing. And when it comes to the big decisions we need to secure our economic growth for the future, I think people are beginning to wonder whether Labour actually has a plan at all, because we have had absolutely nothing in the 12 weeks that they've been in office.
So I've been pretty dubious about the £22 billion claim, but what I've been more interested in and more impressed by is both the OBR and the Institute for Fiscal Studies talking about the medium-term position in tax and spending and saying, if we go on as a country as we are, we simply won't be able to fund our commitments in the medium term. So at some point, political parties are going to have to confront either that we're making too big state commitments or that we're not financing them enough. And that obviously causes a problem for a political party that wants both higher spending or at least that wants better public services and at the same time wants lower taxes. So first of all, is this, before sort of asking you how you might solve this, is this analysis something that you accept?
I do, and I think everyone knows in their heart of hearts that if you're looking 10, 20, 30 years ahead, with an ageing population and all the pressures on the NHS and the care system, and then you look at what Putin is doing in Ukraine and the desperate need to put more money into defence and get our European friends to put money into defence as well, then there's a lot of pressure, longer term pressure on public finances. Now, what the OBR said in their analysis, which I thought was the crucial thing, everyone talked about this, you know, 300 trillion gap that there was going to be, but what they also said was if we increase our productivity growth by just 1% a year ahead of current levels, then the entire gap disappears. And that was why in the budget I said, well, look, what's the obvious thing for the government to do? Start with the 20% of the economy that we directly control, the public sector. And that was why we announced our public sector productivity program, starting with the NHS and that big investment, the £3.4 billion that we gave to the NHS to improve its IT systems. Now, public sector productivity generally, that is a really good example of the kind of difficult decision that a good government is really going to have to get to grips with. But what do we get from this Labour government? £9.4 billion public sector pay rise, double inflation, triple inflation, in the case of the junior doctors, nine times inflation, without asking for a single improvement in productivity in return. So if you do the maths, just pumping £9 billion more into public sector pay is going to reduce public sector productivity at a time when it is already 6% lower than it was pre-pandemic. So that is not taking a difficult decision, that is ducking a difficult decision on the issue productivity that most economists say is the most important one for the economy if we're going to raise living standards.
But, you know, one would have to look back at the history of government attempts to increase the trend rate of growth and say it's not a very impressive record. And Conservatives are very sceptical about, you know, government's ability to simply magic that up. If you'd been re-elected as Chancellor of the Exchequer, do you have confidence that you would have been able to actually achieve that? And what would you have done?
I do, actually, because, you know, if you look at the NHS, for example, if we just take the public sector for a moment, and then I'll look at the private sector and the overall growth. In the NHS, between 2010 and 2019, during which I was health secretary for six of the 9 years, we got productivity growth to 1.5% a year. And the agreement I struck with the NHS at the budget this year was that they would get it to 2% a year. So it's raising their game, but I don't think it's raising it unreasonably from what they were delivering pre-pandemic. If you look at the economy as a whole, how are we going to improve productivity? I mean, we're in the age of AI. Thanks to the efforts of successive Conservative governments, the UK now has the third largest tech sector in the world after the United States and China. And I would say, how are we going to, in the long run, pay for things like the NHS and our armed forces? We've got to try and become the world's next Silicon Valley, and I think we've got a real chance of doing so. But again, what was one of the first decisions the new government took? To cancel the exascale computer project at Edinburgh University, which was one of the things that was going to give us a commanding position in AI.
Yeah, how realistic was it that a Conservative government had been re-elected would have been able to engage in the sort of tax cutting we talked about at the general election? Because it looked to me like we were facing quite difficult both strategic and tactical problem in public spending and tax cutting, the demographic problem you've already talked about. Conservatives talk a lot about tax cuts, and you'd have to do all the things you talked about in productivity even to stand still. So, you know, people like the Resolution Foundation argue the ability of any political party to sort of float itself politically on tax cuts is just gone. Is that an analysis you would recognise?
Look, I think it is going to be, of course, a challenge to bring down the tax burden. We'd started on that journey. And, you know, I don't pretend that it doesn't require difficult decisions, but it's a very important strategic decision. If we want to be a dynamic economy, and Conservatives look around the world, and we say that the countries that are growing the fastest in North America and Asia tend to be ones with lower tax burdens. In the case of the UK, the difficult thing that we need to reform, which would both fund that but is also very good for the economy and indeed for society, is to tackle the problems that we have in our welfare state, and in particular the fact that every year we are, since the pandemic, we've been signing off 80,000 people a year who we say are not just too ill to work, but they're too ill even to consider looking for work, so they are automatically signed off, and only 1% of that cohort get back into the world of work every month, so it comes down very, very slowly. So my worry about the last 12 weeks is that Labour have got themselves so badly burnt with the mess they've got into over winter fuel allowance that welfare reform will now become untouchable for them, because they just won't want to have... I mean, you know, if they worried about a battle with the Labour Party on, you know, benefits paid to pensioners, including wealthier pensioners, you can imagine how challenging it will be to tackle the bill for working age disabled people, which is due to increase by £25 billion a year over the next 5 years. It's a huge, huge increase. But, you know, the argument we Conservatives make is that if you do have mental health issues, one of the worst possible things is to be signed off having to look for work, because that means your isolation is likely to increase and your mental health problems are likely to get worse. So that is a very, very crucial area, both for public finances and also if we want to reduce the dependence on immigration in the economy, that really needs to be tackled. And, you know, I think as Conservatives in opposition, we've got to be making the case strongly that those are the kind of difficult decisions the government should be taking.
So Labour's going to introduce more employment rights, which I think the Conservative Party will attempt to argue, I think correctly, that this will reduce the growth they're hoping to promote. But it's also a political trap, obviously. Once it's introduced, it'll be very difficult to reverse. And the Conservative Party will find itself opposing rights that people will like. So how does one navigate politically, first of all, the stance initially, balancing the growth versus the fact that people like these rights, and then the strategic problem, once you've opposed them, do you promise to reverse them? Do you get stuck?
Well, these are calls where we have to recognise, you know, we were beaten fair and square in the election, and, you know, we have to think like an opposition. And all I would say is that, you know, when you think like an opposition, the reason that the electorate changed their mind about you and decide that having thrown you out, actually they want to trust you again, is if they can see that you are advocating proper solutions and not always the easy solutions. So I think it's very important as we embark on this new chapter that we don't always jump on the easiest bandwagons, because the electorate are watching carefully. So I think on all these issues, if there's a principal case to make that the changes Labour are making are going to damage employment, mean fewer jobs, mean unemployment goes up, then of course we should make that case. But what we need to remember more than anything else, I mean, I think that sadly every Labour government in history has left with unemployment higher than when they arrived in. I think if they do what Angela Rayner wants, that will happen to this government. We need to be a party that has the solution to these problems and does so in a credible way.
Let me ask you a couple of questions that relate to your success as a candidate at the election, but also to the party's broader lack of success in the general election. First of all, your own. You held off the Liberal Democrats, and now there's this debate in the party. Does the party need to face towards the Liberal Democrats and get votes back from the Liberal Democrats that it lost, or does it need to fight reform? Some people say, obviously, we need to do both. Mathematically, you can see that that's the case, but it's very difficult to do that. So what does it do in this dilemma?
Well, I think first thing to say is that a number of the people who were part of my campaign in Godalming and Ash are in the audience. And can I just take the liberty of asking everyone to give them a big round of applause, because they did an amazing job. I think the answer to that question, without sounding too much like Boris and having your cake and eating it, is that we need votes from all those groups. We need reform votes, we need Liberal Democrat votes, we need the votes of people who stayed at home, and the trap to fall into, and it is a trap, is to think that as people get fed up with the Labour government, and judging by the last 12 weeks, that's starting to happen far more quickly than people were expecting. But as they get fed up, to assume that they will automatically come back to us. I mean, we were trounced at the election. We got ourselves into a position where, and this is a very uncomfortable thing for Conservatives, but we got ourselves into a position when people looked at the problems the country faced and the problems in the NHS and the cost of living crisis and all these things, challenges with immigration, and they began to think that we were part of the problem, not part of the solution. That is very uncomfortable. Now, you know, I know, and you know, everyone in this hall knows, that we faced the most enormous global challenges over the last 14 years. We took the tough and difficult decisions to get the country back on track, but it doesn't work just to tell that to the electorate. We tried that at the election. We now have to earn their trust and show that we have listened. And if we win that big argument, the argument that we are actually prepared to take the difficult decisions that will secure the extraordinary future of this country, that it's our potential to do so, then we will start to get voters back from left, right and centre. If we follow a narrow political strategy of saying we're just going to go for this group of voters on this issue and that group of voters on that issue, people will think we're thinking about ourselves, not about the country. So that's why I think I am actually very encouraged when I listen to what our four outstanding leadership candidates are saying. They are thinking about those big issues. They are getting into the mindset that we had in 2005 when I was first elected. How do we win this argument so that we can get back into office in one term and not two or three as happened before?
And just last thing, Theresa May argued this week in my paper in the Times that elections are won in the centre. There are some people who say, look, that is a, you know, an old analysis. We're in a different world now after Brexit. Do you still think she's right?
She is absolutely right that we will not win the next election if we say all we want is this group of voters on this part of the spectrum, and that will get us, you know, over 40% in the polls. You need to win a broader argument with the country. And this is what I would say, and maybe it's a slightly different way to the way that Theresa put it, but I think it's probably arguing the same thing. What is the biggest challenge we face as a party? Our biggest strategic challenge is the fact that the average age above which you are more likely to vote Conservative than Labour is now over 60. If we are the party of aspiration, we have to have a message for 30-somethings, 40-somethings starting out on their life who are prepared to work hard, who are Conservatives to their fingertips in their values, in the way they lead their lives, in their belief, in all the things that all of us believe in. We have to have a message that appeals to them. So I would say, as we rebuild our trust with the British people, a litmus test of whether we are on track is whether we are starting to do things that rebuild confidence, trust and excitement amongst those generations, because they're not just the future of the country, they're the future of our party as well.
Jeremy Hunt, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.